My name is Rose Amador LeBeau. I am president and CEO of CTC. Our mission is to help people through employment and education become self-sufficient. We have a day worker center. We have educational programs so people can get their GEDs. We serve a variety of people, people who've just become unemployed, people who have never worked. We work with homeless people. We work with people who have just gotten out of prison and have to re-enter the workforce. So we're full service. I think it's seeing people make the change, become successful, make that transition, and actually having an impact on people's lives, a positive impact. To see these success stories is what it's all about. Joining us on Native Voice TV, I'm Cihuapilli Rose Amador LeBeau, and you are watching Native Voice TV. I have a really great show for you today because we have a real actor with us today. And I'd like to welcome Joseph Valdez. Welcome, Joseph.
Oh, thank you. So glad to be here.
He's in town from the LA area.
Yep, I'm in from LA.
And you're going to be doing a play in San Jose.
I'm doing The Memory Stick at San Jose Stage opening this Saturday. That's right.
And what's so unique about The Memory Stick?
Well, it's about a Lakota Sioux in the military in Afghanistan, mm-hmm. and he's lost his identity. He's through war, through the things that he has seen, through even historical trauma from reservation life, he's lost kind of who he is. And a feather, an eagle feather, actually falls from the sky in Afghanistan to the burn pit where he works, and he starts to rediscover who he is. And he has the ghost of Crazy Horse there to help him out, and he kind of is able to heal the wounds of battle, the wounds of obedience, the wounds of historical trauma.
How amazing. Now, how is this associated with Dublin? Didn't I see something
San Jose is actually the sister city of Dublin, Ireland.
Right, right.
And I guess they got together to work on this play. San Jose Stage Company flew over to Ireland, and they had readings of several playwrights, and they chose Donal O'Kelly. And they chose him because, now I'm paraphrasing, Donald said something like, no one has been subjugated like the Irish, save the Native American. And he wrote this play about a Native American in Afghanistan. You know, and it has Irish elements in it. Uh-huh. One of the characters is from Ireland originally, and she has a lot of Irish mythology that also helps Jack, my character, rediscover who he is.
And is there comparisons? I saw something in the write-up about Wounded Knee.
That's right, yeah. So my character's dad was one of the goons that shot up Wounded Knee, who was fighting against the American Indian movement in the protest of 1973.
Right.
And so, you know, my dad in the play fought in Vietnam. He also has the battle scars of Vietnam. He went down the tunnels, you know, and he went down there with a handgun and a knife, and, you know, you could just imagine what kind of things he had to deal with down there just to survive. And that carries on through his life after, and our relationship, where he was pretty much non-existent. He became a drinker, and essentially, he was never able to overcome the wound of his soul, and so that also, you know, is something that Jack considers. Do I want to be like that? Because ultimately he knows his dad is a good human being.
Right.
You know, but he has these scars, and now that he's been through Afghanistan and he's seen things, he understands where his dad is coming from. And, you know, he makes up his mind not to do that, to go and seek visions and to seek healing.
Oh, fascinating.
Yeah, it's a powerful piece of storytelling.
I'm anxious to see it. We're going to see it on Saturday.
Yeah, I can't wait.
I had a friend, well, it's an elder who's now passed on, and he fought in Vietnam. And because he was Native, they thought, okay, he looks a lot like Vietnamese, you know. And they would have him take pictures of the bridges that they eventually were going to blow up. But at the time, he had no idea why he was taking these pictures, you know. Mm. And so it's the same kind of conflict that you're talking about there. And about just last month, we were in South Dakota, and we went by where the battle was, and I said, is that the Jumping Bull Ranch? And it's all deserted now, the house and everything. And so just to hear, you know, this story is going to be fascinating.
Yeah. Yeah. And, you know, I come from a military family. My grandfather fought in World War II. My godfather fought in Vietnam. My godbrother is an Army Ranger, you know, so there's a lot of pride that has come with being Native and a military family. You know, my grandfather has this amazing story. He went, he was in World War II, and he went on the beaches of Normandy a couple days after D-Day, and he survived, and he makes his way through France, and he gets to Vire, and he's shot in the head. And he gets taken by German soldiers, and he gets to this basement in France somewhere, and the German soldiers are drinking, and they're having a good time, and they keep on offering him wine, you know, and he's like, no, I don't want nothing. I don't want nothing. They offer him a sandwich. No, I don't want nothing. And then the big guys come in, and they start to interrogate him. And this is my favorite story that my grandfather used to say. And at this point, he would smile, and he'd get that big smile, like grandpa's smile, and he would say, I don't know nothing. I'm Indian. And they said, all right. They made a bed for him upstairs. He woke up the next day. Nobody was there. Ran back to Allied forces, and they gave him a cup of coffee.
Wow.
Shot in the head. They sent him to England for 3 months. Helped him heal, and he was back out on the front lines and won a couple more medals, a couple silver stars and such like that.
You know, my dad has a silver star, too, for being on the beach of Normandy. He blew a hole in the wall so they could get through.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. It's amazing. Huh?
Yeah. My grandfather got his silver star actually in Germany. Mm-hmm. Towards the end of the war, they were trying to build a bridge over a river, and they sent my grandfather on the other side of the river to kind of, you know, protect it, and there was an attempted siege that my grandfather shot down. So that's how he got his Silver Star.
Amazing.
Yeah.
Now, you are Dine?
Yes, I am Dine. Yes.
And your family's from, originally from the
New
Albuquerque
Mexico
area?
Yeah, just north of Albuquerque. I keep on getting the town wrong. I was never, you know, my grandfather was so happy to be back from World War II that he married my grandmother and he had 14 kids.
Oh my goodness.
So I have about 35 cousins and I'm in the younger end. So I never got the trip to New Mexico. So so I never got to see where we were from, but I always get the town wrong. I always say Española, but that's wrong.
There's a town called.
I know.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. I always thought it was Española, but it's just north of Albuquerque.
It's near there.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
Well, if you're just tuning in, you're watching Native Voice TV, and we're talking to Joseph Valdez, who's an actor, and he's here in San Jose, so he is performing a play.
That's right.
Play here in town, and you're doing two plays, too.
I'm doing two plays. Yeah, I'm doing this crazy thing where I fly back and forth. I'm actually doing a play in Hemet, California. It's California's official state play. It's been going on since 1923. It's based off of true events that happened towards the later part of the 1800s, about a Native American man by the name of Juan Diego, who mistakenly took the wrong horse. And when he tried to bring the horse back, actually the guy who owned the horse hunted him down and not only shot him, shot him with a rifle, then came up to him and shot him several times with a pistol, and then took the butt of his rifle and smashed his face in. So there was actually a Native American advocate by the name of Helen Hunt Jackson who had been trying to get Congress to pass friendly Native American legislation, and she wasn't able to get anywhere. So she wrote this romantic novel called Ramona, kind of as a protest to what's going on. And it was the second best-selling romantic novel of the 19th century.
Really?
And so this town of Hemet, California, where this atrocity took place, started this play in 1923, and it's been going on ever since. 3 years ago, they readapted the play, and they invited me to be a part of it. And so here I am. I play a Native American character. The tribe is ambiguous on purpose because it could represent pretty much any Native American in California at that time. It takes place during the transition from Mexican rule to American rule. So, you know, the Native American community is really searching on ways to survive. My family has gone into sheep shearing. We feel like we found a great way of adapting. And the Americanos come in, and while I'm away sheep shearing at the ranch where Ramona is, my whole family is killed. The village is burnt down, and I come away and I've lost everything, and I've fallen in love with Ramona, and I ask Ramona to come away with me, and we go away together. We have a family, and more devastation happens. You know, kind of one thing after another, which kind of is what happened in California.
That's true.
In the 19th
That's
century. True. So it's exciting, it's a spectacle, people love it. It's like Romeo and Juliet, except cowboys and Indians.
Is it always only performed there?
It is only performed there in this, it's a 5,000 seat amphitheater. It's beautiful outdoor space. There's a mountain. I run up and down. I come in on a horse. There's about 20 horses in the play. I mean, the community here loves it. There's about 300 to 500 volunteers that come in and do the play every year. So we have kids on the mountain who come up, and we have Native dancers who come in and do powwow style dancing. The Red Tail Spirit Dancers. They're an amazing group of American Indians around, I think from Saboba mainly. But they come in and they dance, and we have powwow, we have drum. And it's just such an uplifting, amazing thing that I get to be a part of.
I have to put that on my bucket list to
go
see
play. That's right.
So tell me, how long have you been acting? I went to your website and saw your resume. And you've done a lot of work.
Sure,
film work, theater work.
Yeah, I was a pretty shy kid growing up, but my grandmother was an actor, and
really?
My mother was an actor, and I was like, I'm never gonna do this because I am shy. I'm afraid of girls. I'm afraid of talking in front of people, so there's no way I'm gonna do this. And when my mom went back to school, she studied psychology, but she also studied, she double majored in psychology and drama. And I was in high school at the time, and they asked me, my mom would always get me in the plays. And I did, my mom did a lot of Chicano theater, then they had a Chicano theater program, so my mom did that. She did, she did Marisol, which I was a part of, Stinkin' Badges by Luis Valdez.
You're not related to those Valdez.
I'm not,
right?
No. No. And I did Richard III, I was the prince in Richard III, and so I did that, and then when I got to college, you know, I was just searching of who I am, identity. Mm-hmm. And I just came across theater, and I rediscovered writing, and then I rediscovered, you know, oh, this is my voice. I have something to say. Mm-hmm. I have something important to do. I feel empowered. And so I went to community college first, and there was a regional theater on campus, and I did this regional theater, which was an amazing, it was a guy from Frank Condon from LA, came in, and he talked me into going to USC. It was between Berkeley and USC. I actually signed my letter of intent to go to Berkeley. And I went to USC on a presidential scholarship to study theater.
Wow.
And that's, you know, it's been, I've been so happy since. And I've been a part of many projects that are just so inspiring, and just a group of people in theater just so inspiring, you know, empowering. And when you know you're doing your job right, it's like a vacuum. You know, you're on stage and you feel everybody's soul there with you. And there's a lot of power to that. You know, there's a lot of empowerment that can happen in the community.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely. And it's so good to see a Native actor.
Yeah.
I mean, we relish that because they always have somebody play a Native.
That's right.
Right?
That's right. It's, you know, the history of Hollywood is atrocious in terms of Native. I mean, they got Italians to do it, you know. But it's starting
just
to change.
Just the dark makeup, right?
Oh, that's right. Yeah, just, you know, just put red face on and everything will be okay, right? And talk in some kind of weird accent.
Exactly.
And then, you know, everything's okay. And it's not okay. We still exist. We're still here. We're survivors and we're powerful people. And we deserve to tell our own stories. And that's a major thing in the Native American community right now is who is allowed to tell our stories.
That's right.
You know, and there's power there. I've seen it. I'm a part of an amazing theater group.
Oh, yeah, I wanted to ask you about this. I'm glad you brought that
up. Yeah, I'm a part of an amazing theater group in Los Angeles called Native Voices.
I like the name.
Yeah, right. And it's the only Native American theater company, professional Native American theater company that is strictly for Native Americans. So we kind of have this ragtag, motley crew of Native Americans across the country who are in LA, who are actors or writers, who do theater, who tell our stories. And it's powerful stuff. It's amazing, and I'm so lucky to be a part of it. It actually started because Randy Reinholtz, who is the artistic director, he's Choctaw, I believe. He was a professor at a Midwest college, I don't remember the college. But the dean asked them, you know, let's do a Native American play. So they went looking for Native American plays, and they did not find one. Not one. So Randy and his wife Jean said, you know what? We're going to create something that attracts Native American playwrights. And so they've been doing it for over 20 years, I believe. And it's housed at the Autry Theater. The Autry Museum in Los Angeles, and they've been going strong since.
That's good. We need so many more.
Oh, and there's so much stuff going on. Like they're taking, Randy adapted Measure for Measure as it's called, basically it's adapted into the boarding school system. It's called Off the Rails, and it's going to Ashland, Oregon. It's part of the Ashland, Oregon Shakespeare Festival this year. So, and there's, you know, I have friends that are working across the country, both in film and television. So it's really...
And we need more.
We need
I went
more.
To a play at Santa Clara University, I think it was last year sometime. And the Native role was played by someone else because they didn't have a Native actor at Santa Clara University.
Yeah.
And that's one of the first things I asked Ron, who's on the board of the stage, when he mentioned coming to the theater there. And I said, and about this play. And I go, oh, who's playing the Native American? He goes, he's Dine. And I went, oh, okay.
Yeah.
Made a big difference.
Yeah.
I mean, really, as a Native person, when you hear that there's going to be a movie or a play or something, you know, it's, you want to know who's playing
that's
us.
That's right.
You know?
That's right. I mean, the Native community is so strong in terms of support, you know, and it's important. I also did a traveling show with a theater group called Will & Company, and it's basically educational theater. And they have, so basically the premise is, it's been 50 years since the March on Washington, Martin Luther King's March on Washington. What's been going on? Have things been better, improved? And they have different, they have an African American one, they have a Latino one, they also have a Native American one. So what's been going on in the last 50 years since? And it talks, I mean, it hits you hard. It talks about historical trauma. Mm-hmm. It talks about suicide. It talks about forced sterilization, all these things. And I remember one time we went to Washington and the state of Washington. Mm-hmm. And we did it at a community college. And this Native teenager was sobbing in the middle of it, like just crying. You could hear her because it just hit there. And we finished the play, and she just gave me one of the best hugs I've ever had in my life. And her aunt came up to me, and she said, keep doing what you're doing, because it matters. Because it's important for us to see that we can make it. And I'm just like, I'm just doing this traveling show. Like, I don't feel like I've made it, you know. But it's important.
You're a role model out there. You're a role model for the kids, for the... You know, one of the reservations that I visited recently, they were talking about suicide, the kids, and it's not, they don't talk about trying suicide. It was like either they say attempted or completed. You know, it's...
Yeah.
Either work, you know, I mean, it's sad. It's sad when the kids think there's no hope, you know, there's no future.
Well, and I think with Jack, my character, he's originally from Pine Ridge. Now, he goes and lives with his grandma in the city, Rapid City. Mm-hmm. And, but there's that same thing that he's dealt with, you know, like who am I? You know, I mean, you look at the boarding, Jack's grandparents went through the boarding school system, mm-hmm. you know, where they strip your identity away and they tell you you're a second class citizen.
Don't speak the language.
That's right. Mm-hmm. You know, and what was lost there? We still, I mean, I don't know. I think a lot of us don't know what exactly was lost in that transition. And that's what I think is so powerful about this play is like, you know what? Our ancestors are still here.
That's right.
You know, whether you, like, I'm not a spiritual person or anything like that, but my ancestors are still here. I look up at the sky and I see my ancestors.
Right.
And they give me power. When I was at USC, I took a solo performance class. And for our final, we had to write between a 5 and 15 minute solo performance. And I used to lock up the church at USC. And so it was quiet. And so I would write there and I just, they didn't know what to write. And I just started writing about this kid lost in the woods, this little boy lost in the woods. And he gets helped by bear. My favorite myth is the cannibalistic basket woman from the Northwest. And he's being chased by cannibalistic basket woman. Mm-hmm. And he's getting helped by bear and by snake and by a couple other animals. And he makes it to the cliff and white buffalo calf woman comes out and blesses him, and he heals cannibalistic basket woman, and she turns into this beautiful woman. Mm. You know, like, where did that come from? Like,
yeah.
I just sat down writing, but there was something, you know, whether it's the ancestors, whatever it was telling me, you know what, this is, and it's a mixture of different stories, but that's what I wrote, and it got me, actually, that's how I got introduced to Native voices in Los Angeles.
That's fascinating.
Yeah.
Well, I'm really looking forward to seeing the play on Saturday.
Yeah.
And so do we have any future plans for big screen? Is that an ultimate goal? I hope so.
Absolutely.
Because we'd like to see you on the big screen.
You know, I keep on kicking the door. I just haven't been able to kick it in yet. So.
And you would think with so few Native actors,
you would think it's hard. I don't know. I have to solve the equation. Mm-hmm. And get in there. I have, you know, I keep on telling important stories, powerful stories. You know, there will be a path for me. There is a path for me.
Absolutely.
And it will be in film, it will be in television, it will be on the stage. I will find a way to tell these stories.
So I'll get your autograph now. So it'll be also, I knew him when.
That's right. Yeah.
Before he became famous and went and signed my paper.
You're so nice.
But yeah. No, we're looking forward to that because we don't have that. Yeah. And you also teach school? You substitute for school, work with kids?
I work with kids. I teach at a school in South Central. I do long-term subbing. So if there's a teacher on maternity leave or a teacher gets sick or sometimes they have open positions, I'll go in there and I'll fill it for 30 days. Mm-hmm. So right before, actually, I just got done teaching AP Literature and a writing seminar class mm-hmm. with these amazing kids from South Central who, they're really special kids and inspirational, and they have so much that they're dealing with.
Yeah.
But they get through it. You know, I've
so
learned a lot
potential,
from them. They have so much potential.
It's just overlooked.
Yeah. You know, they're the cycle of poverty. Mm-hmm. You know, it's hard to overcome.
Absolutely.
You know, I was lucky to have my mom who went, you know, and she taught me. She went back to school and she persevered no matter. I mean, we went through a lot of hard things in our life, a lot of tough things, some trauma, but she persevered and she showed me the way, which is important. You know,
and you said she was an actress?
She was an actor, yeah.
Yeah. Is it an actor, actress? Or is it just actor?
Yeah, yeah. Actress, actor, yeah.
And did she do theater or what did she do?
So she went back to school when I was in middle school and she went to Sac State and she studied psychology and drama. So she double majored. And she would, I was a shy kid, so they would get me to do the shows. So I did a couple shows. They had a big Chicano theater program there, so she did a lot of Chicano theater. She did Marisol, she did Stinking Badges by Luis Valdez. Yeah, and it just kind of, that's when that seed was planted, mm-hmm. you know, that plays or show business, it doesn't have to be glitz and glamour. It could be, you know, the powerful story that inspires. And that's what I've held on to ever since.
Well, that's something Theatre Campesino does, huh? Just bare minimum, but they
that's
get their
right.
point across. That's
right.
how it started.
Yeah. And actually, one of my mentors, Frank, actually worked with Luis back when they did theater on the back of trucks.
Right. Back you in know. The Cesar Chavez boycott days.
That's right.
Yeah. Well, thank you so much for being here.
Thanks for having me.
And should I say break a leg?
Yeah, break a leg.
Break a leg. Yeah. We'll see you on Saturday, and we'll see you on the big screen soon.
I appreciate it, hopefully.
Yeah.
One day.
Thank you for joining us. Like us on Facebook, and we'll see you next Sunday. Native Voice TV.
Indigenous soul. Indigenous soul. Indigenous soul.